This morning's gospel is John's depiction of the call of Philip and Nathanael to follow Jesus. Now, we also hear about the call of Samuel in the Old Testament lesson, and today's psalm indicates that we are called before we are even born. Everyone gathered here this morning is called. I remember when I was probably 35 years ago, I'm guessing, I went to see a priest on the staff at the Church of the Incarnation in Dallas and stammered around and said, "I think that I may be being called." And he gave the perfect answer and said, "Everyone is called. We need to discern your call." Call is rooted in baptism. By our baptism, we are a people called out for a purpose beyond ourselves. And the Greek word for church actually means the people called out. And having said that, I do want to emphasize this morning that baptism is more than plugging in as part of the body in order to do the work of the church. It is more than getting a job assignment in order to help the body function. Paul writes of the church as a body, specifically the body of Christ, and each of us is a member of the risen body of Christ. And some are called to be apostles, and some prophets, and some teachers, and so forth. Every member has a calling, a role, all of that is true. In a sense, we do plug in to serve the body, to build up the body. But this morning I want to suggest that the calling is all of those things, and it's something more. For your baptism is more than plugging in as part of the body to do the work of the church. Philip and Nathanael are called to something beyond themselves. The calling has a purpose beyond them. But the calling is also more than church work, however noble and valuable and needed that is. When we speak of baptism, we speak of baptism as a new birth. It is the beginning of a life of conversion to Christ. And it includes a lifelong journey to discover two things, more I imagine, but two things in particular today, to discover our truest selves and our deepest longings. For we as human beings have a great thirst for purpose and meaning in life. We have a deep desire to actually connect our faith and our service, a desire to connect faith and service at the heart level. Now, the writer and spiritual director, Frederick Buechner, he defines our true calling as the place where our deep gladness meets the world's deep need. So simply put, if we are honest, we want the two to match. And that is a question of discernment and vocation. The word vocation comes from the Latin word voice. And so we think of discerning vocation as listening for the voice, listening for the calling. Parker Palmer, a Quaker, and Quakers do a lot more listening than speaking, he says that vocation does not mean a goal that I pursue. It means a calling that I hear. And yet vocation does not come from a voice out there calling me to something I am not. Comes from a voice in here, calling me to be the person I was born to be, accepting the treasure of the true self that I already possess. So true calling, true vocation, intersects with true self. The two meet. In other words, we're not called to be something we're not. I think you know that. We're not called to pretend to be someone we are not. I'm not called to be Pope Francis or Bishop Michael Curry. I'm called to be Scott. We're not called to fake it for the highest cause. Rather, we are called to discover and be who we are. Authentic selfhood. Now, I'm not talking about chores and challenges we don't want to do. I'm talking about the intersection between authenticity and vocation. Between true self and true calling, not pretending, but being who we are, and trusting that God wants that and calls us to that, and that our true nature is called by God for a purpose beyond ourselves. Now, Parker Palmer, the previously mentioned Quaker, has written a little book entitled Let Your Life Speak. And I recommend it to anyone who's working through a period of discernment. Let Your Life Speak. And in this little book, he tells a story about the intersection between true self and a calling to serve God's purposes. And it's perhaps a particularly appropriate story as we celebrate Martin Luther King Jr. tomorrow. It tells a story which takes place on December the 1st in 1955 in Montgomery, Alabama. An African-American woman, a seamstress in her early 40s, Rosa Parks, you know the story, did something she wasn't supposed to do. She sat down at the front of the bus in one of the seats reserved for the white people, which at that time, of course, was a dangerous and daring and provocative act in a racist society. And years later, someone would ask Rosa Parks why she sat down at the front of the bus on that day, and her answer is a little bit surprising because it's not at all spectacular. She did not say that she sat down to launch a movement. Her motives were much more basic and elemental than that. She said, "I sat down because I was tired." And Palmer suggests she did not mean that her feet were tired. She meant that her soul was tired. Her heart was tired. Her whole being was tired of playing by racist rules, of denying her soul's claim to selfhood. Palmer says, the moment she sat down at the front of the bus on that December day, it was a moment of existential truth, of claiming authentic selfhood, of reclaiming her birthright, reclaiming God's gift. In that moment, she set in motion a process that changed both the lay of the land and the law of the land. Rosa Parks sat down, he said, because she reached a point where it was essential to embrace her true vocation, not as someone who would reshape our society, but as someone who would live out her full self in the world. She decided, I will no longer act on the outside in a way that contradicts the truth on the inside. I will no longer act as if I were less than the whole person I know myself inwardly to be. And perhaps what follows is Palmer's chief point. He says we can look at the great liberation movements of our times, South Africa, Eastern Europe, among women, African Americans, and what we see is simple but often ignored. The movements that transform us in our world emerge from the lives of people who make a choice for authenticity. In the face of political systems which force them to live in a way that is untrue to who they are and risking punishment, they decide to live divided no more. They decide to no longer act on the outside in a way that contradicts some truth on the inside. They decide to claim authentic selfhood and act it out. And their decisions ripple out to change the society in which they live, serving millions of others. Palmer calls this the Rosa Parks decision. Every day, you and I are faced with the same decision. To pretend and fake it, or to claim authenticity, to claim our true nature, to reclaim God's gift. One defining moment on a bus ripples out to liberate a land. One defining moment on a cross ripples out to liberate a world. Defining moments and ripples. I would suggest that's what happens at baptism. We enter the waters of baptism, and God creates a ripple. That's true for each of us as individual members of the body. It's true for the whole body of Christ. It's true for us, the people of St. Andrew's Episcopal Church. We enter the waters of baptism, and we are called to our true vocation, to embody the attributes of Jesus, to embody the love of Jesus, a love without conditions, to embody the grace of Jesus, unmerited grace, to embody the forgiveness of Jesus. To forgive from the cross, no apologies first, no general confession first. To embody the compassion of Jesus, who touches the leper. And to embody the mercy of Jesus, for when we fail. We step into the waters of baptism, and true vocation is claimed. Who you are born to be is accepted and claimed, and we participate in what happens next. A ripple effect, as all are liberated by the good news of God's unconditional love, which we are called to proclaim in the name of the